Good evening, everyone. After a couple of sessions on the accounting-related issues and compliances, ICAi Jinulsha now welcome you all to have over the next and final session on the reporting compliances. The Companies Act requires the auditor's report of specified companies to include the statement on prescribed matters. These reporting requirements have been prescribed under the Companies Auditor's Report Order, or CARO, as we all know it. The CARO stipulates mandatory reporting requirement by the statutory auditors on certain issues. We have our learned speaker, CA Anand Bathiya, to address the key issues in audit report and reporting under CARO. Now I request CA Sanket Shah to introduce our speaker, CA Anand Bathiya, and to escort him to the dais.
Good afternoon, friends. Respected members on the dais, of the dais. On behalf of Ahmedabad Bar Branch, I am honored to introduce our learned faculty, CA Anand Bathiya sir. He is the fellow member of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. He has done the postgraduate diploma holder in securities law from government law post qualification, diploma holder in information system audit from ICAi. He is the partner at Bathiya and Associates LLP and engaged in advisory service vertical with previous experience of having worked with leading accounting firms in India. He is assisting companies in relation to the complex financials reporting requirements, including first time implementation of IFRS Ind AS, part of the team with audited India's largest IFRS financial statements in that year. Hands on a specialized experience in handling issues in relation to the business combination of financial instruments. He is closely engaged in the assisting Indian corporates in raising inquiry equity resource through listing on the Indian and international capital markets, venture capital, etc. He is also involved in various corporate consulting, group restructuring, fund advisory, and financial reporting. He is the co-opted member of the subgroup constituted for formulating and recommending valuation standards of Ministry of Corporate Affairs. He is managing committee member of Bombay Chartered Accountant Associations and co-opted member on various committees over the years of Western Indian Regional Council. He has invited various speakers at Ministry of Corporate Affairs, ICAi, ICSI, WIRC, BIGASA, etc. He is closely involved with various entrepreneurs in mentoring, assisting various new age business in the FinTech and active member of Young Leaders Forum of Indian Merchant Chamber and the Indus Entrepreneur. Overall, he is having the vast experience in the field Indias. Now I request CA Jignesh Parikh to offer a memento and bouquet to our learned faculty.
When Sanket started, it was afternoon and now it is evening. So good evening, friends. Thank you, Sanket, for the introduction. And thank you, Jinal, for the opening remarks. You could pronounce my surname properly, so congratulations to you in that. Otherwise, I'm all over the place from Bhatia to Bathiya and wherever. Good evening to all office bearers, especially the young, energetic, and dynamic chairman and ever-smiling Chintan Patel, Parag Bhai Rawal. His selfless service and devotion to the profession is what brings all of us to Ahmedabad. Friends, we have been talking about change and change since morning. I heard the opening remarks of Dolphy, Khushru, the CFOs. And yes, change is inevitable. Change is all pervasive. That is why maybe Chintan in the logo also has kept change as ICE. On a lighter side, can someone change this weather of Ahmedabad, which is 42 degrees? And let's change that if possible. We accountants are used to changes. Changes will be there, changes were there, and changes are there. I don't think that we cannot surmount change. There is a little bit of turbulence nowadays because of the speed of change and because of the multifaceted dimension to the change that is happening. For example, when I last came here, it was maybe 2 years before, on a seminar on Companies Act 2013. From that day till today, you won't believe there are 270 new pronouncements that have come up which have amended the Companies Act 2013. Can you imagine the 1956 Act, till the time it was amended, had 250 pronouncements or amendments? And in the last 2.5 years, we have 250 amendments or pronouncements. You just cannot read the bare act and advise to the client. There can be a different dimension in the rules. The rules can override the act. There can be a notification, circular, order, guidance, guidelines, whatever you want to call. But the jurisprudence is scattered and it is fast changing. It is one of the problems of delegated legislation, that it is fast changing. Coming to the accounting side, we had the old Indian GAAP and we had the IFRS version of Ind AS. Companies have not yet even declared the first set of results. The phase one companies will come out with their annual reports over the next 2 to 3 months. But there are 8 exposure drafts which are issued by the IASB, and India is trailing by 8 drafts. So you can imagine the change and the pace of change that is happening, which is why knowledge management becomes very critical in terms of what we are doing. It's an established fact that no longer we can be generalist, we need to be specialist, but a key element will be knowledge management and how we manage knowledge in the coming days. The topic given to me over the next 1 hour is to speak about auditor's appointment, auditor's rotation and reporting. We will not spend much time on appointment and rotation because that is fairly standard and there are not many changes that have happened over the last 1 year. And we'll spend more time on reporting, which is what all of us getting into the audit season or reporting season should be aware about. Chapter 10 of the Companies Act. In Mahabharata and Gita, we say Dasmo Adhyay. Chapter 10 is the Gita for all professionals, especially chartered accountants. Because that's the one chapter which has 10 sections, which covers the roles, responsibilities, duties, obligation and liability of auditors who are auditing the under the Companies Act. It also tells us how I as a practitioner can structure my firm. Can I have non-chartered accountant partners? How many audits can I do? And multiple things which are not only related to audit, but also as how I am structured as a practice unit are covered by these sections. So these 10 sections must read before you are doing any audit. And there is one rule, that is the company's audit and auditor's rule 2014. Together, they will not be more than 20 pages. But it has complexities and it is something that all of us must read. We know how from a CA Act, we need to accept appointment of a audit. First, we will send a eligibility. Then we'll get a resolution, then a members, then an NOC of the previous auditor, and then I conclude an engagement letter. From the company's perspective, the responsibility is slightly more than what it was under the old act. This is thanks to the Satyam issue that happened, where the auditors were involved in that particular fiasco. The first step is it needs to go to the audit committee. And large companies have a mandatory requirement to form an audit committee. The audit committee needs to consider the qualifications and experience of the auditor. So there is an onerous responsibility that is casted on the audit committee. And keep in mind, audit committee constitutes of majority of independent directors. So you maybe have one nominee of the promoter, but the other two are independent directors, and they will decide whether a particular auditor is qualified and eligible as far as the experience is concerned. He also needs to mandatorily evaluate whether there are any proceedings that are going on of professional misconduct against that particular auditor or the audit firm, which was not there earlier. So today, if someone asks you for an eligibility, you have to give a list of what all complaints are pending, not only with the disciplinary committee of the council, but also if there is any court or any regulator, you need to give a list of all proceedings that are pending. The audit committee will consider that and then it will recommend to the board. The board may choose to not agree with the auditor's recommendation and can say, look, I don't agree and please come up with other suggestion. That is also possible. In that case, the audit committee can either stick to its preference or give one more alternative. After that, it's the prerogative of the board The board can bulldoze the audit committee and ultimately recommend to the members who the auditor should be. And then the members appoint. So the first three layers are additional layers which have now come up, and the responsibility is casted on the audit committee to recommend and evaluate the appropriateness of that auditor. Auditors were erstwhile appointed for 1 year. Now we have the requirement to have appointment in the winter session. But the bill has a provision that there is no need to ratify. Once you appoint for 5 years, that is it. The auditor cannot be removed without central government consent and without a special resolution passed by the members. So that does come in. But as of now, though it looks like a 5 year appointment, ratification each year means that you are at the mercy of the shareholders and the management. In case you are a company that is covered by rotation, then you need to, and if your auditor is a sole proprietor, you will have to appoint another auditor, and the same auditor cannot continue. And if it is a firm, you can further appoint that firm for a period of 5 years, and that firm can continue effectively for 10 years. That firm can again come in after a cooling period of 5 years, is the requirement. Now the question or the issue over here that comes is, if I am a firm and I am being appointed as an auditor, can the same signing partner continue for 5 years and for a further period of 5 years? The answer is the Act says it's okay. So as long as the firm is reappointed, the partner, the same partner can continue for 10 years. However, the Institute's requirement, recommendation and code of ethics suggest that after frequently you should also change the audit partner, which is recommended at 7 years. But effectively the Act says that if it is a firm, the partner can continue for 10 years. Which companies are eligible for rotation? All listed companies have to mandatorily rotate their auditors. Even certain unlisted companies need to rotate their auditors. If it is an unlisted public company who has a share capital of more than 10 crores, mind you, share capital over here includes your preference capital plus equity capital. Or if the borrowings from banks, financial institutions or public deposits are more than 50 crores, and in case of a private limited company, the threshold of paid up capital is 20 crores, then these companies need to mandatorily rotate their auditors. There are transition provisions that an auditor or an audit firm who on 1st April 2017 has completed the 5 years or the 10 years, then this is the year, that is 2017-18, is the year where you need to get out and a new set of eyes needs to come to audit. As per one guesstimate, there are about 7,500 companies which are liable to change their auditors in this year. And the audit or the AGM that will come in August, September, you'll see many companies going for new auditors, going for joint auditors, and the rotation effectively kicks in from this year while the 3 year transition period is now over. If it is a common partner in that same firm, if you belong to the same brand, if you work under the same trade name, then also you are disqualified from being freshly appointed on account of rotation. This 5+5 is a highest limit. The shareholders of the company can pass a resolution that my auditor will rotate every 3 years or every 2 years. If that is the case, then the rotation for you is 3 years and not 5 years. Similarly, members can also pass a resolution that the audit partner will change after every 3 years or every 5 years. Then that is something that will also need to be followed. And members can resolve for joint audit. So if the members pass a resolution that there needs to be mandatory joint audit, then the management doesn't have a choice. They will have to recommend two set of auditors, and two set of auditors will need to be appointed. Many of us would be aware that about 3 to 4 months before, there was a SOS which was sent by about 20 leading national accounting firms to the PMO that the Indian auditing profession is dying. And it was all over the media. I'm not sure if many of you caught. And now there is a group that has been set up under the chairmanship of Mr. Ashok Chawla. And the group has to recommend how the Indian national firms can grow in size. And one of the key recommendations is joint audit. That at least in terms of the large companies which are there, can joint oil be mandated? Is it positive? Is it negative? And public opinions were attracted. And over the next 1 to 2 months, the report of this committee should be out, and that will pave way of for the future of auditing profession as far as the nationalized accounting firms are concerned. Who is eligible to be an auditor? First, the guy who gives a consent that yes, I take the risk and I'm willing to become an auditor, and I am not debarred by the CA Act, I'm not debarred by the Companies Act, and I don't have any disciplinary proceedings. That's the guy. If it's a CA firm which has majority of partners as CA, then that firm is eligible. Now, this is a development that came under the Companies Act 2013, has gone unnoticed, but the Act permits me to have even non-CAs as partners in my partnership. The institute is still not up to the speed in terms of having provisions where I can have non-chartered accountant as members, but there is a thinking that is going on to have multidisciplinary partners, and the Act does provide that even if 50% of or 50+1% of members or partners are CAs, then yes, you can be an auditor for the company. The auditor should not be an employee. Auditor's relative should not be a KMP. These are all okay. The last one is important. If I am owning security, or if any of my relative is owning security, or if my partner is owning security, by security it means shares, preference shares, debentures, any of that is security as per SCRA, then I cannot be auditor of that company. The extent of coverage is not only the company, but it also extends to the holding company, to the subsidiary company, to the associate company, and also to the subsidiary of the holding company. For example, if I am auditor of Tata Motors, then I cannot own even a single share of Tata Steel, of Tata Tea, of TCS, because they have a common parent of Tata Sons. And this also extends to relatives and partners. Now, to relatives, they have brought in an exemption that up to 1 lakh rupee of face value, the relative can continue to own. However, that is restricted only to the company. If you read the language of that particular section, to that oddity, my relative can own up to 1 lakh. But to the holding company, to the subsidiary company, to the associate, to the sister subsidiary, the relative technically cannot own even one share. And the relative is there are 10 relationships which are a part of relative, and I'm not sure how can I stop my mother-in-law from buying shares of a company. If she knows that I'm an auditor, she would first go and buy. And no one on earth has control on mother-in-laws. Fortunately, mother-in-laws are not a part of relatives, so don't worry. But yes, you have these 10 relations, and if any of them own even one share, you are disqualified. So you are technically at the mercy. Even if your partner owns even one share in the oddity, then make sure that you will be disqualified under the Act. You shouldn't have any business relationship with the company. Now, business relationship was very generic. If I am having a Vodafone phone, then can I audit Vodafone? The Act was saying no. The rules have clarified that if it is in the ordinary course of business at arm's length, then you can continue to do. So rule does give a leeway, but you shouldn't have business relationship. The auditor shouldn't be an auditor in more than 20 companies. Now the Act said blanket 20 companies. The rules have given some leeway that if it is a small company, dormant company, one-person company, and certain private limited companies, less than 100 crore of paid up capital, then they will not be included in your 20 limit. The error which most of us do is that we forget to realize that a subsidiary of a public company is also a public company. So when you are calculating your list of 20, make sure that if there is a private limited company who has a paid up capital of less than 100 crore, but if it is a subsidiary of a public company, then it will still be counted as one audit, and you will have to reduce your number of eligibility by that. Auditor is convicted of fraud. This again, thanks to the Satyam issue, came over here. If an auditor is convicted for fraud for 10 years, he cannot act as an auditor in a company. Mind it, you cannot provide any service to the company, to its holding company, and to a subsidiary company without having a board resolution. Even giving a certificate or even giving a tax audit requires a board resolution. This is also one thing that we are lacking in compliance. As a general thing, what many firms have started doing is that while you take resolution for appointment of auditor, you should take one more resolution to include certain certification, tax audit, and some of the other things which we may be supposed to do over the 1 year. So we check the box there. But technically, if there's no board resolution, you cannot provide a single service. And certain services you just can't provide, even if you have a board resolution, which is all these 8 categories, internal audit, investment banking. The gray area here is management services. What is management services is clearly anyone's guess. Something like a tax representation may also be management service for someone, and it may not be a management service for someone. There is a request to the institute and to various regulators to clarify on management service or what the scope is, but that is not clear as of now. The FAQs. So my personal view is that it is not management service, because management service is when you get into the shoes of the management, and let's say you are dictating certain instructions to the staff in relation to business or some of the other matters. If it is return filing, in my view, it is not management service, but till such time, it is not clear. This is anyone's guess. So this is the sum and substance of auditor appointment and rotation, right? Now appointment is done. We have completed the audit. Now comes the question of reporting. Audit reporting, as we usually call, is bifurcated in my view in 4 different categories. The first one is report on the financial statements, which is basically the first page to the members of ABC Limited, where we say that the financial statements are true and fair, where we say that this is in compliance with accounting standards, whichever gap we are using, the old gap or the Ind AS, and where we say certain additional requirements as per Companies Act, which have also been complied. Then we have the CARO, which is an annexure to the auditor's report. We have another annexure, which is the internal financial control report. And there is one more reporting, which is the fraud reporting, for which there is no report, but that is also deemed reporting from the Companies Act perspective. The internal financial control, many companies last year have given it as a separate annexure to the audit report. However, it is not mandatory to have it as a separate annexure. There is an illustrative format available wherein the clauses of that annexure are also inbuilt as a part of the main report only, and you will only have one annexure, that is CARO. But usually, when we copy paste, or I should use the word best practices, when we are looking at best practices, we follow, and most of us would have done an annexure of the report of IFC. In August 2016, the institute has come up with a guidance note, which is guiding me how do I decipher the guidance note on IFC. The guidance note on IFC itself is complex, so they came out with a guidance note to guide me how should I read the guidance note. That guidance note is applicable for small and less complex entities, wherein they have given this illustrative format where IFC is merged with your normal report. And this year, we will see many companies coming out with the merged report and not coming out with separate report for IFC. SAA 700 or SA 700. Naam to suna hoga? Any other auditing standard you have heard other than SA 700? Okay, let's take a survey. How many accounting standards are there today in India? 30. Any other guesses? How many accounting standards? Come on, we are all chartered accountants. We should know how many accounting standards, number of accounting standards which are there, right? 32, 30, 34. Any other guesses? 32, 31. We have 32 notified accounting standards. What is AS1? Name? Disclosure. AS2? AS3? Okay. Now, how many auditing standards are there? Anyone? Acha, name 3 auditing standards. Anyone? Forget 1, 2, 3. it's not an audit standard anymore. Name, forget the content. Ask yourself that our capabilities of accounting standards and our capabilities of auditing standards and where we stand. I'm not saying that we don't do audit. Whether we do audit as per requirements of auditing standards is the question. Up till now, it was okay because auditing standards were issued by the institute, and in case you do not follow the auditing standards, the institute will come behind you and debar you for 1 year. Now, auditing standards are a part of the Companies Act. So, non-compliance of auditing standards has the same penalties as non-compliance of accounting standards. And it is not that I am asking this question first time. I have been asking this question 3 years before and 5 years before also. And I have got the same answer. So, I am not expecting that, you know, we will be proficient in auditing, but I can only hope that, you know, given the liabilities and given some of the compliance costs that can be there under the Companies Act, we will also slowly gear up on our knowledge of auditing standards. For example, internal financial control over financial reporting, it came last year. But it was always there in the auditing standards. You had to do control testing before you can do a substantive testing or analytical review. It is just that the reporting explicitly happened in this year, and everyone was focused on IFC in that year. But for the last 20 years that we have been signing accounts, IFC was still there. You still need to do that. So SA 700 is the standard. Like all things, even SA 700 is changing. So from next year, we have a new SA 700 and a new format of auditing standards. So more reason for us to meet again. But for now, SA 700 in the form and shape it is addressed to the members of the company. Now, this is a misnomer because this format has been picked up from some internationally accepted format and it says to the members. We have also been historically saying that to the members. Our appointment is by the members and we'll report only to the members. No one else can tell me anything. That has changed. Come Companies Act 2013, the concept from shareholder has moved to stakeholder. And it is not only for auditors, it is everywhere. You talk about CSR, right? Corporate social responsibility. It's a classic stakeholder concept. I always have dividend for my shareholders. Over and above dividend, I have to give a CSR spend of 2%. Now that's a stakeholder concept. Or independent directors, no longer for minority shareholders. They are there for various category of things. Similarly, the audit report, anyone can rely on an audit report, including tax authorities, including creditors, and including any person who is affected by your report can rely and can sue you in case there is a misstatement in your audit report. So the perspective, the liability risks have changed, and we'll have a separate slide on that, but this to the members is a misnomer, it is only a salutation now. We start with the first paragraph, we have audited. If it is standalone, we write about standalone. If it is console, we write about console. If we are giving as per IGAAP, we give the reference to the old GAAP. If it is the Ind AS, we now have to give under the Ind AS. Anyone working here in a company that is converging into Ind AS or auditing a company that might converge to Ind AS? Not many, right? So we'll focus our discussion on accounting standards. But the only change in the report that will go out for Ind AS companies is that the comfort will not only be for profit and loss, balance sheet and cash flow, but also for the statement of change in equity. Because there's one more statement that comes in the Ind AS format. So you need to give comfort on each of these four statements and not on the three statements. Otherwise, more or less, the format remains the same. Then we tell the users that, look, it's the responsibility of the management. My is only a limited responsibility, other two paragraphs. And then it's the opinion which comes, which is a true and fair opinion. I can have emphasis of matter in that same paragraph, and sometimes people also disclose other matter. For example, if I am a parent company auditor and I have not audited the subsidiary, I would mention it over here in this last paragraph under other matters that this quantum of results are not audited by me. And the last paragraph, which has again come up by the Companies Act, is a report on legal and regulatory requirements, which we'll talk about in the next slide. For Ind AS companies and what is the responsibility of an auditor, there's also an implementation guide, which is mentioned over here. And if any one of y'all are working on auditing an Ind AS company, then this is something that y'all should consider reading. What is this last point? That is report on legal and regulatory requirement. That is something that we are discussing next. So section 143, it's also a very famous section under the Income Tax Act. 143 has a different connotation in Bollywood movies, and 143 has a different connotation in our Companies Act. 143.1 is deemed reporting, and 143.3 is express reporting. What 143.3 says that you have to comment that you have looked into these things. And 143.1 says that this is what you have to do. Only if there is a deviation do you need to comment on those items. Now, as most of us follow best practices, all our reports will surely have the express disclosures. But not many would have applied mine whether I need to disclose something which is a part of the deemed reporting. And some of the items in the deemed reporting are so thin that many of us may fall under that requirement. For example, let's consider the third item. Shares, debentures, and other securities have been sold at a price less than which they were purchased. Now, that is possible in so many companies that we would have audited. But do we evaluate that? Yes, as an auditor, it is my job to inquire that why you have sold the shares less than the purchase price. And if I'm not comfortable, and if it is a material amount, I need to disclose in my auditor's report. Because it's deemed reporting, no company has disclosed, so I have not disclosed. But these 143.1 are deemed reporting. And for a fact, each of these were also there in the Companies Act 1956. None of these are new. The change is that the new report format now has a catch-all clause which says that if there is anything material in your judgment, please disclose. So the Institute guidance note says that if there is something within the deemed reporting clause that you want to highlight, use that catch-all clause and put it over there. So now the reporting obligation of the deemed reporting comes in, which was earlier only an inquiry and not reporting. Express reporting. This we have to do. We have to make a positive statement that we have sought and obtained all information and explanation. You cannot, after signing the audit report, say that, no, I didn't get this information. No, I didn't get this explanation. There needs to be an express statement in every audit report to say that you have received this. You have to say that proper books of accounts as required by law have been kept by the company. If branch office has sent you some reports, you need to mention that. But there's an exemption that if your company doesn't have a branch, then this clause is not applicable. You may choose not to report on this. Company's balance sheet and profit and loss are in agreement with the books of accounts. This needs to be mentioned as a express reporting. And for Ind AS companies, you also need to disclose that whether the statement of change in equity is matching with the books of accounts when you're preparing report as per Ind AS. This is the financial statements comply with accounting standards, is again a catch-all clause. But the next one is the key catch-all clause that has now come. The observation or comments of auditors on financial transactions which may have an adverse effect on the functioning of the company. It doesn't say material adverse effect. It's saying adverse effect on the functioning of the company. Now, if there is something under the deemed reporting that you feel is adverse, this is an obligation for you to disclose. The idea is that the auditor's report need not be a straitjacket report. It needs to be a speaking report. You need to communicate to the shareholders what are the other adverse findings that you have. It doesn't mean that you have qualified your report. These are only observations which you are highlighting so that there can be some information sharing and there can be some speaking engagement with the users of financial statements. We have moved a long way from earlier where the auditors were just required to sign and stamp. What happens with the notaries today? Right? They don't give you a report of notarization. They sign and stamp and it's a notary. We had started as an accounting profession with just one sign on the left-hand side and the directors on the right-hand side. From there on, we have moved, and the contents of the audit report have been improving and have been increasing. The revised format of SA 700 is almost 1.5 times of what it is right now. The idea again is to speak. The idea again is to communicate and just not give a blanket statement that it is true and fair. So this is a key change in terms of how we see and how we perform our audit. Because we would have taken various materiality assumptions. We would have taken various calls when we are doing our audit, which might not affect the true and fair position of the company, but it might still be an adverse thing in the financial position of the company. So this gets triggered and you are required to report it over here. Again, when we follow best practices, these two clauses are something which are reportable only if there is an item that you have to report. So many of the large companies may not have this clause, but doesn't mean that that reporting requirement has been evaporated. A director has been disqualified, we have been doing so and now we have to continue to do. Or any qualification, reservation or advance remark relating to maintenance of accounts and other matters. So the first catch-all was in relation to the adverse effect on the financial position. And the second is if the accounting system is not maintained properly, then also you are required to talk and inform the users that what is the issue. This is not a qualification, but this is something that you have to disclose. There's again a guidance note on this. There's no dearth of guidance note in reporting. There's a guidance note on reporting on these two specific clauses, which is the two catch-all clauses. And that guidance note is also available on the Institute's website. Sorry, sir? 143.1? Sir, this... Last year was the first year when this new format came up. I have seen one very small private limited company where they have reported on the shares, which is why I remember that particular clause. Because the company had purchased for, let's say, 1 lakh rupee and it sold for 10 lakh rupee. And being a small company, there was a loss. Whereas the book value of the company was still there. Book value of the company where they have invested was still there. So there was no reason for them to sell it at a 10,000 rupee. And when you do that, then it's a deemed reporting triggered and they have reported under F. Express reporting continues. You have to report whether internal financial control system is in place and whether it is operating effectively or not. So IFC starts with designing a system. It goes into implementing the system and it goes into testing of the operating effectiveness. And you are required to report on all these three aspects. This is where we give a link to Annexure C, which is where the full report comes. And if you will follow the short form format, which is now available in this clause itself, you will give a comfort on the internal financial control reporting. Impact of pending litigations on the financial position. We have been reporting this in contingent liability. So what most of the auditors have done is that they are cross-referring it to the note which is there for contingent liability and which is where they have disclosed. And whether provision is made for material foreseeable losses, including derivatives. Taking color from the point that each of these three CFOs was saying on foreign exchange, derivatives, one of them spoke about the credit default swap. All of these instruments and exotic stuff, whether provision has been done or not, is the job of the auditor to confirm. So this is again a fallout of the subprime crisis where there were a lot of these derivatives in the book sitting. But valuation of that is a complex thing. But now, yes, as an auditor, we need to make sure that all material foreseeable losses are provided for, including specifically on derivatives. There's emphasis on derivatives, though the general material foreseeable losses do continue. So time to evaluate as to how we can value a derivative and how we can be sure whether the derivative requires provisioning or not, especially when some of these are very complex things. And if there is a delay in transferring funds to IEPF, which is the Investor Education and Protection Fund, then you disclose that. Earlier it was part of CARO, now it has been brought over here. A new thing, thanks to the 811 demonetization, is a disclosure on specified banknotes. So the Schedule 3 was amended, and there is a disclosure that companies need to make in their notes to accounts in terms of holding of demonetized or specified banknotes, and they also need to disclose how have they transacted in those specified banknotes for the period from 8/11 till 30th December. And there's a format. Schedule 3 was amended, and similarly, the obligation on auditor was also cast that in the auditor's report, we will now have to mention what is the holding of specified banknotes, what is the transactions that have happened in the specified banknotes, and the most important, whether that matches with the books of accounts or not. So that's an obligation that has been cast on the auditor, and it's technically a post facto because this came up on 30th of March, this obligation to report, and all of this has already happened. So how much comfort I can give is a big challenge. Institute has come up with a guidance note on what needs to be done, but the requirement is to disclose holdings, dealings, as well as whether they're in accordance with books of accounts. This is the format that every company will now have to give. Important fact over here is that this is not a part of CARO. This is a part of the normal auditor's report. So every company, irrespective of it having CARO or not, will have to give this disclosure. You start with a column on SBN, which is the 500 and the 1000 rupee note. The next is all other denominations, and you come to the total cash that the company has. You start with the closing cash on hand as on 8/11/2016. Now, how do you, even have a comfort what was the cash on hand on an odd date like 8/11/2016? And then you have to show whether they have been used for permitted expenses. For example, petrol, medical was permitted for some time and then it was closed. And there has been so many seesaws in between. There have been at least 20 changes from 8/11 till 30 as to something is allowable, something is not allowable. There are limits to allowability. So then whether you have received permitted, whether you have paid permitted, what is it that you have deposited in the bank and what is the total? Total for sure needs to be zero because there was a mandate to deposit everything. But other denominations also you have to mention, and then it tallies with your books of accounts. The question is, do I mention number of notes or do I mention the value? The guidance is that you mention the value and you do not mention the number of notes. But the guidance note says that when you are obtaining the report from the management, you should take both in terms of the number of SBNs and also the value of SBNs. There is a implementation guide on this as well, which is available, and you guys can review that online. What needs to be done? Very important, and we'll spend 2 minutes on this because this is applicable for everyone. The first step, what the guidance note says, is that take a closing cash balance from management. What was the closing cash balance as on 8/11 and as of 30/12? Obtain an understanding on the controls and procedures implemented by the company during the period. So whether there was any instruction required, what was it, how did the management ensure that no one spends that money? There are news reports to say that company X was doing, company Y was doing, but essentially now the auditors will have to disclose actually something like that happened or not. Whether those controls were implemented, that's the next question to be asked. Confirm balances as certified by the management with the books of accounts on those dates. This is the key point where whatever the management says, you'll have to go back and see on that day as to whether that cash balance was there or not. You will for sure not be able to trace the denomination because that is not captured in the accounting system. But for sure, the number and the quantum is something that you will have to evaluate. If you have done a stock take and a cash count somewhere in the interim, then you have to do roll forward or roll back procedures to arrive at the disclosed number. For example, we audit a company that has a 31st December year end. And as an audit procedure, we would have done cash counting as of 31st December 2016. Now I need to do rollback procedures that what is the cash that they have spent on one day so that I can come back at the figure of 30th December 2016 and document that. Obtain a listing from management how the notes were spent, permitted versus not permitted, which management will give, you need to go and ask. But yes, they need to give you a statement where the notes have gone. You need to report in cases where the company has spent for non-permitted transactions. So this is an additional obligation that a guidance note is casting. The requirement of MCA is only caring, holding and compliance with books of accounts. The guidance note says that if they have spent for non-permitted purposes, let's be a partner in nation building. And you know, let's qualify if we come to know that they have spent for non-permitted purposes. Verify payment vouchers and verify deposit slips. Post that, call for bank statements and check whether on those dates there has been deposits or not. And then obtain management representation. This is the process that we need to do in hindsight, because none of us could have forecasted in that time that what is the cash position. But some of these things may not be so easily available, which is where the guidance note gives us 6 situations that can happen. And they have given us format as to in which situation you need to report what. Before that, the big father of IT, Infosys, came up with its full-fledged financial statements, and it has given a disclosure of specified banknotes. It starts with, it's a bit low to read, but I'll read it out. It's the same format, and they have mentioned the SBNs, other denominations, and total. A good part is that the SBNs will always be a round figure, because it's either a 500 note or a 1000 note. So, you know, don't think that if it's a round figure, it's, you know, something that has been cooked up. But it should be a round figure, because those SBNs are 500 and 1000 notes. It is possible that the company discloses and the auditor is comfortable, and you have a format in the guidance note of how you should report. That's iteration 1. It is possible that the clause is not applicable to the company. I don't have any cash balance. That's also possible, and then the second iteration is something that you have to disclose. It is possible that the company discloses, but the auditor is unable to verify. There are no payment slips, there are no deposits, there are no bank statements available, and I cannot give a comfort. That's the third version, and you need to use that iteration. Or if the company does not disclose, then you have to the fourth iteration. Company provides partial disclosures. There's a fifth iteration, and the company has dealt in non-permitted transactions. If you identify a case where the company has dealt in non-permitted transaction, then the format is there. The most critical format, which should be there and which is missing, is what if the company has disclosed, I have all the information, but it does not match with the books of accounts. That disclosure and what should I write is something that is not clear. The 7 reporting scenarios, an MR clause, the management representation clause that you should include, has also been given. So please ensure that the MRs that you take or give have these kind of clauses to cover SBN reporting. IFC reporting, internal financial control reporting, nothing new. We have to do the same thing that we have been doing the last year, applicable to all companies. The only thing is that now you can have a short form version of IFC report and you don't have to give an annexure. So consider using that short form version and save paper. There's a guidance note, another 2 guidance note. One is on the long form and second is on the short form. So if it's a less complex entity, these are the characteristics of a less complex entity, then you follow the less complex guidance note. And if not, then you follow a full-fledged guidance note. Coming to CARO, no major change in CARO as compared to what we had reported last year and what we are going to report this year. CARO earlier was 2003, then it was 2015, and now the version that we have is CARO 2016. It is applicable to all companies except private companies who have paid up capital plus reserves of less than 1 crore and borrowings from banks and financial institutions of less than 1 crore and turnover of less than 10 crores. Important to note over here is that the borrowing requirement is not as of the balance sheet date, but at any point of time during the year. So you will need to work out as to what is the maximum borrowing that the company had at any point of time during the year and then evaluate. Similarly, if this entity, a private limited company, is a subsidiary of a public company, it doesn't get this exemption, you will have to give CARO. CARO additionally provides that if it is a holding company of a public company, then also CARO is applicable to it. So it's the reverse way as well. So if your subsidiary is public and your holding is private, then also CARO is applicable to that entity. It is not applicable to 1-person company, small company, and banking, insurance, and Section 8 company, which is the not-for-profit entity. Anyone knows what's a small company? So small company is a new animal, and that animal requires that the paid-up capital should be less than 50 lakhs, and the turnover should be less than 2 crores. If I comply both of these conditions, I am a SMC, I get exemption from CARO. I can have only 2 board meetings in a year and not 4. I don't have to have a cash flow statement in my books of accounts, and I don't need to have a company secretary to sign my annual report. Are the 4 benefits that I get if I am a SMC. Questions come is that whether CARO is required for consolidated financial statements. Any guesses? No. CARO is not required for CFS, that's correct. Whether CARO applicable to branch audit of a company? If I have a branch, then does that branch need to give me a separate CARO? The answer is yes. The requirements of CARO also apply if you are doing a separate branch audit. The branch auditor's report will have to have CARO, which you will consolidate into your CARO and give a consolidated reporting. Whether exemption to CARO also applies to Section 25 companies, which is the erstwhile avatar of not-for-profit, which is Section 8 now, because the CARO clearly said Section 8, but the FAQ is now available, which says that it also applies to Section 25 companies. Whether share application money to be considered as a part of paid-up capital plus reserves. Any guesses? No. No share application money. It has to be paid in capital and reserves and surplus. Outstanding dues in relation to corporate credit card, will they be considered in the borrowing limit of 1 crore? Any guesses? If I have a corporate credit card, my monthly outstanding is 5 lakh. Do I need to add it to my borrowing and then check my limit, or it is just the limit? Because my borrowings don't necessarily figure in my balance sheet sometimes. The answer is yes. You have to catch hold of all the corporate credit cards, see what is the borrowing, add it to your book borrowing, and then evaluate what is the CARO applicability. Whether borrowing from NBFC covered in financial institution? Any guesses? The India Bulls giving me a loan of 5 crores, does it trigger CARO for me? The answer is yes, because NBFC is also a financial institution and CARO requirement is there. This is the example where company A has a paid up capital of 25 lakhs, reserves of 5 crores, and turnover of 1 crore. Whether CARO will be applicable to such a company? Correct. So it's a small company because the turnover and the paid up capital limits are breached. Even though it doesn't fall under the exemption of private company, it is an exemption under small company. So all of these are individual exemptions, and even if they fit in any one of them, you can take that exemption. What are the additional disclosures which came up in CARO 2016? One is the title deeds of immovable property need to be verified, which even last year was there, which is a teething point. Section 185 and 186 of the Companies Act have been complied or not. Now, when we saw various audit reports, what we figured out is that even for private limited companies, there is a disclosure of compliance with Section 185. Now, strictly speaking, from 5th June 2015, private limited companies, certain private limited companies were exempted from 185. So if the company that you are reporting for is not covered under 185, then you should not give a comfort for 185. Similar is the situation for 197, which is managerial remuneration. That doesn't apply to private limited companies. So you shouldn't make an express statement that the company is in compliance, rather restrain for that. Details of defaults to banks, details of how the funds of IPO and FPO and term loans have been raised needs to be disclosed, and whether they have been applied for their purpose is a requirement to be disclosed. Fraud by or on the company. Now, CARO requires that fraud by the company or on the company needs to be disclosed. The fraud reporting, which is a separate reporting, only triggers when there is a fraud on the company and not by the company. So, slightly differing requirements. In both cases, the fraud against the company should be by the officers, employees. Then only there is a need to report. We came across a case where it was a financial services company and it was giving loans for purchase of scooters, motor cars, etc. And they were distributing these loans through DSAs or direct selling agents. And one of the DSAs did a fraud and the company suffered a loss of 10 crore rupees. The question was, should I disclose that fraud either under CARO or under my fraud reporting? And the conclusion was no, because it's not an employee or an officer who has committed a fraud. It's a third party independent DSA who has gone ahead and committed a fraud. So the conclusion there that the team took is that there's no reporting requirement, because the strict interpretation is that it should be only from an employee and an officer. Officer has been defined under the Companies Act, and it includes directors, key managerial personnel. Key managerial personnel have been further defined under the Companies Act, and it also includes any other person who controls the board of directors. So you may not technically be on the board, but if you are a promoter, then too there are chances that you may qualify for an officer. Managerial remuneration, whether it is in compliance or not, needs to be disclosed. Does not apply to private limited companies, so please don't give any comment in case it's a private limited company. Transaction with related party under section 177 and 188, whether it is in compliance or not, needs to be given. This is slightly challenging. 177 says that every related party transaction first needs to go to the audit committee, which is a very easy thing to check. But the 188 is actually a requirement where I need to test whether it is at arm's length, whether it is in the ordinary course, what sort of a resolution has been taken, whether it goes to the board or it goes to the members. If it goes to the members, whether everyone can vote or someone can vote, and what is the disclosure requirement that I need to make in my annual report. So all those compliances are covered in this clause, and this is one important clause that gets slightly onerous. Preferential allotment, private placement of shares, if you have done, then whether these have been used and the amounts have been used for the purposes needs to be disclosed. Non-cash transactions with a director, if you have bought a land and issued shares to him, it's a non-cash transaction, and disclose details of that if you have complied 192. And this one last one was the NBFC requirement. Now this was always there. Section 45IA RBI circular was there that auditor needs to ensure that if a company is NBFC, then they have to qualify. But express reporting came the last year that auditor has to comment in CARO whether the compliance of 45IA happened or not. Which basically means that if the financial assets of the company are more than 50% of the non-financial assets and the financial revenue is more than non-financial revenue, then it's a NBFC. So you need to check the revenues each year and make sure that it is a non-NBFC. If you will qualify, the ROC will directly forward it to the RBI and the notice will come to the client that this is a NBFC company. Disclosures not required. Transfer to IPF clause has been done away because now it is a part of the audit report only. No need to put it in CARO. There was a disclosure of internal control systems which goes away because now there's an entire format of internal financial controls that we have. Accumulated losses exceed 50% was a requirement which goes away because this was coming by BIFR, the SIC Industrial Companies Act. Now BIFR as a body itself is in BIFR. So you know that SICA Act has been repealed. We have the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. So effectively this 50% requirement is no longer there and that goes away. And guarantee for a loan taken by others was a disclosure, but now we have 185, 186 which basically cover that. Some issues. Non-payment of advance tax. Is it a default of statutory dues that requires reporting under CARO? Many times promoters and management takes a view that 12% interest, if I don't pay advance tax, I'm paying 18% interest, might as well pay advance tax at the end of the year with interest. But do as an auditor, I have to qualify that it was a statutory due, you have not paid in time, and I'll have to qualify in CARO. Any guesses? Yeah, the guidance note strictly says is that the advance tax is also a statutory due. The fact that you can pay interest and you know make good the loss doesn't mean that it's not a statutory due. So even if you have defaulted in advance tax calculation, there's a requirement to report that the statutory dues have, the company has not been regular in terms of depositing statutory dues. Conversion from a partnership to a private limited company. And the partnership company had certain immovable property. Now under part 9 of the old act and now under part 3, I can convert the partnership into company, there is no stamp duty, and effectively the immovable property deeds will always remain in the name of the partnership. Because I have inherited, it's a succession and it's not a transfer. So given that, what do I need to report in the clause that whether the title deeds are being held by the company? These are all life questions that we faced the last year, but we took a view over here that it's a succession and the title deeds continue to be remain in the name of the company only. because there's a ROC order and the report was not qualified, and we said that it is in the name of the company. Whether earlier years continuing default to lenders also to be reported. This year I have not defaulted, but last year I had defaulted. But it's a continuing default. I have paid this year's EMIs completely, but one EMI which was not due is still continuing. Is there a need to report? Any guesses?
Yes.
Even if it is a continuing default and historical default, you need to report. If there is an IPO, I am required to disclose the end use of funds, whether I have ensured that they have been done or not. Sometimes IPOs can be by offer for sale. Like, I don't get any primary subscription into the company, but promoters sell their shares as an offer for sale. In that situation, the company has just not got any funds. So how do I ensure, if I have not got any funds, that where the company is going to spend it for? So the act is not clear, but the guidance note gives some guidance that in case of OFS, this clause will not be applicable. Whether GDR, ADR, and any deviation in the use of those need to be reported, guidance note says no. It strictly applies to IPO and FPO, and according to them, IPO and FPO is dealt with the SEBI guidelines, which is the Indian market, and you don't have to report as far as the ADR, GDRs go. Whether rights issue and end use of rights issue needs to be disclosed? Any guesses? Guidance note says no. Because strictly speaking, it is covering preferential allotment and private placement, which are two different things, and it is a rights issue is a different concept under 62.2. So what they say is that if it is a rights issue, these disclosure requirements are not required. And this is also one issue where we saw in many companies that despite being rights issue, people have said that yes, they have done and they have been deployed. So something that you can take care of. A related party votes on a resolution under section 188 of a private limited company. Now, under section 188, if a matter goes to the members, it is beyond a threshold, then the interested party cannot vote. It's a majority of minority rule. Now, in this private limited company, the related party voted. Do I need to qualify in my CARO non-compliance with 188 is the question. Any thoughts? The answer is no, because for private limited companies, the majority of minority rule does not apply. Again, the 5th June 2015 breather, which is a two-page notification, which was one of the earliest gifts by the BJP government, which gave a breather to private limited companies, also said that the majority of minority rule will not apply to private limited companies. You have to go for a resolution, but everyone can vote in that resolution. So given that, you will not have to disclose for a private limited company. Whether board report needs to provide response for a comment in the CARO report. Now, we all know that if it is an audit report qualification, the board needs to give an explanation to the shareholders. Is it true for CARO? That is correct. Whatever are the CARO is nothing but an annexure to the auditor's report. So if there is any kind of deviation, discrepancy, qualification you have in CARO, that also has to be disclosed or explained by the directors in the director's report. Fraud reporting. Now, this reporting is not, again, an express reporting. It is a deemed reporting. You, as an auditor, are required to report to the central government in case you have a reason to believe that there is a fraud involving more than 1 crore rupees that is committed against the company by its officers or employees. First, you will write to the audit committee or the board of directors within 2 days of coming to know of a fraud. The board can take 45 days, the audit committee can take 45 days and come back to you that, look, these are my reasons and this is how I have mitigated the fraud, or this is why I feel there is no fraud. You will then need to, within 15 days, tell Shastri Bhavan or the central government, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, under a copy to the board of directors, that this is the fraud that has happened. So it's a Hyperion reporting, not only to the shareholders, but to the regulator directly. And you have to follow it up with an email. And this is not a year-end reporting. This is an ongoing reporting. If you are engaged with the company in a different capacity as well, and you identify a fraud, and you are also an auditor, keep in mind that your reporting obligation is triggered throughout the year. And not doing this is a small penalty of 25 lakhs. Not much. This is whistleblowing. And what is whistleblowing in the classical sense? If I want to blow the whistle, I will blow. This tells me you have to blow the whistle. So fraud reporting, thanks to Satyam, it is there now and it is there since the last 1 year. These frauds have clearly colored the Companies Act. The process of changing the Companies Act started sometime in 2003 when Mr. J.J. Irani was appointed and a committee was set up to come up with a concept paper on how the Companies Act should be. From 2003 till 2013, it took 10 years for the regulators to come up with a model law. And in these 10 years, we had four major scams. The first one was the Ketan Parekh thing, which was just coming up at that point of time. Then you had the Satyam in 2008. Then you had the 2G issue sometime in 2010. And then you had the Sahara thing, which is still unfolding. So the first one, Ketan Parekh, you'll see tightening on 185, 186, loans, intercorporate borrowings, all of that thanks to that issue. If you see Satyam, auditors tightening, fraud, independent director, rotation of auditors, liability of auditors, thanks to that particular scam. The third one is the 2G scam, mandatory consolidation, control of overseas subsidiaries is now available with the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. SFIO is now a part of the company's Serious Fraud Investigation Office. And the fourth, the Sahara, you will see preferential allotment, public deposits, all of that is tightened beyond the norm in this new Companies Act. So what started as a proactive process to change the law ended up with a reactive process in where we are. On a lighter side, in US, when laws are formed, the person who makes the law is given credit of the name of that law. For example, HSR is the competition law in US. It is known as Hart-Scott-Rodino, which are three legislatures who formed that law. Or SOX, Sarbanes-Oxley. Or the recent Obamacare. Obama was there in that pharmaceutical, so he is the legislature and that's the name of the law. If this law had to be given a name, it would be SRK. That's not Shah Rukh Khan, but it is Sahara, Raju and Ketan, who have lent their name to the law, which is where we have the law today in terms of completely colored by fraud. If fraud is less than 1 crore, no need to go to the central government. You can report to the board and the audit committee. All frauds to be disclosed in the director's report. Even if it is less than 1 crore, it is the responsibility of the management to disclose in the board. CARO fraud reporting includes by the company as well. So this is slight dichotomy which we need to keep in mind. And there is a guidance note on this as well. So there's a guidance note on reporting for fraud, which you can read at your ease. The last slide that I want to highlight on is when we are getting into this audit season, certification season, let's understand what liability we query. And let's then sign the financial statements, keeping in mind the liability that we carry. And I would want each one of us to read this clause verbatim. Now we skip clauses, but we have to read this because signing any financial statement, you carry this risk. Even if you're from the company side, the auditor that you are engaging with carries this risk. And if the auditor is coming up with questions and requirements, keep in mind that this is something that is mandated by law and this is the liability that is casted on the auditor. The 1956 Act had no liability provisions on the auditors. It was only the institute and the disciplinary committee of the institute where someone can file a complaint and the disciplinary committee will take care of that CA. Now we have liability provisions. It starts with section 147. First is that it's a joint and several liability of the entire firm and not just of the signing partner. So earlier it was signing partner, I don't care what my partner in Indore is doing and I am here good sitting merry, that doesn't work. The entire firm will be liable for fines and monetary damages, and criminal liability is restricted to the signing partner and to the partner who is conniving with that particular criminal partner. The auditor shall be punishable with a fine which shall not be less than 25,000 rupees but which may extend up to 5 lakh rupees. The provision under the bill is that 5 lakh is less or more, it should be linked to the audit fees. So 4 times the audit fees is the cap that they want. for a basic mistake that you have in the auditor's report. However, if the auditor has contravened the provisions knowingly or willfully. Now, willfully I can understand. Willfully is mens rea. Essentially, I have a fraud intention and I'm doing it willfully. But knowingly, as an auditor, you want me to know. And knowingly is also an obligation if with an intention to deceive the company or the shareholders or creditors or tax authorities, then he shall be punished with imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 1 year, and it is not and slash or, so it is not compoundable. If it is and slash or, you can go for compounding. If it is or, it is discretionary into what penalty can come, but this is and. So jail is a must, plus there is a fine which shall not be less than 1 lakh rupee and which may extend up to 25 lakh rupee, and the provision, the requirement and the request is that it should extend up to 8 times of the audit fee. This is the basic galti hua, 25 lakh rupiah deke aa jane ka. However, to top it up, if you have been convicted, you refund the remuneration received by the auditor. Anyways, we don't get much, but whatever limited we get, go and give it back to the company because they have suffered the loss. And the next one is a big dampener, pay for damages to the company, to statutory body, to authority, or to any other person for loss arising out of incorrect or misleading statements of particular made in the audit report. Any other person, tax authorities, statutory authorities can come to you and say, hey, your audit report doesn't mention this fact, I will sue you, and damages. And this is happening. These provisions have been notified. I at least know of 10 litigations which are currently going on in the NCLT, where auditors have been made party. Professionals are soft target, right? Two partners fighting, make auditor the party. There is an operation and mismanagement case filed by one party, joint venture, make auditor the party. So once you give power in India to sue someone, the Indian judicial system sometimes is that the process is much more than the punishment. Someone goes and files a suit in Guwahati, the process for me to go and represent even innocent itself can be more than the punishment. So power is there to directly sue the auditor by anyone. He need not be a shareholder. The company's bill 2016 proposes that to remove any other person with members and creditors, but that is still not there. So any other person may go away and it may be replaced with statutory bodies, authorities, company, member and creditor. But as of now, we are obliged to pay damages to anyone who comes to us to ask. It is like insurance. Any loss to you, come to me, I will pay you the damages. As simple. There is imprisonment up to 25 years plus fees plus damages. The good part is that they have not given capital punishment to auditors. Fasi ke saza nahi. So they have stopped at imprisonment, fines, damages, and now the provision is to have NFRA. We know NFRA, anyone? National Financial Reporting Authority. This is the only provision of the Companies Act that has still not been notified, and thankfully so. And the institute needs to get credit for not having this notified. But the provisions herein are that the disciplinary mechanism goes to the NFRA. Above NFRA, there is an appellate tribunal, which is known as NFRAT. N-F-R-A-T. So any appeal from NFRA goes to NFRAT, and even breach of auditing standards has the same 25 lakh penalty, has the same damages as compared to not only auditing standards. Class action suits, auditors can be made party. And this section has been notified. NCLT is now in place. 100 shareholders can come together and file a suit against the auditor to say that the auditor is not acting properly. The whole firm can be debarred up to 10 years by the NFRA. And fraud reporting is also something that is there. So with these kind of penal provisions, whenever we are getting into this reporting season, we need to make sure that the landscape has not only changed as far as the technical requirements go, but the landscape has changed significantly as far as the liability, as far as the risks, and as far as the issues that can happen potentially with the auditor. And with this, friends, I would like to thank you for a patient hearing. And maybe we can take some questions if there are any. Thank you. Sir, whistleblowing or fraud is in limited situations where it is against the company by employee and officer. But this is not restricted to only those situations, but this is restricted to all situations where you are in the know of something.
You are expected to act as whistleblower in every situation and you will say that. Huh.
Should not have been there. So the representation that has gone to the ministry, one of them is also to remove the word knowingly, but that is not a part of the bill as of now.
If there is any fraud committed by third party, then there is need to show it in the directors.
No. You can proactively disclose if there is a fraud that has happened, and the directors may choose to disclose, but as an auditor, you don't have a liability to report to anyone. It will be technically a loan that you have given to the director. So you need to ensure section 185, which is a reporting under CARO. It might strictly not be non-cash, but it is still a loan in effect that you have given to the director. So direct or indirect?
Director's card is used.
So then essentially it's the expense of the company. So then to that extent, I as an auditor, the company is not in a worst off position. The company has got funds. What you may need to see is the public deposit rules, because money is coming to the company. But if it is a director, the company can take a loan from the director. That is allowed. So I don't see as an issue there. Yeah. So till such time they have not given a permission, it is a public limited company.
Yeah, absolutely.
From the time they give that particular consent, then you need to see you are a private limited company for all purposes. So the requirement of private limited company, if rotation is not applicable, it will not apply to you. If it is a non-cash, then it is not a part of this limit. But the moment the non-cash comes in your books, for example, you have given a LC and that is encashed, and then it comes from a contingent liability to a book loan, then it comes. But till such time it is contingent, that limit is not considered. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for enhancing our knowledge and giving us the clarity. I hereby request CA Shwetang Rao to propose a vote of thanks.
Allow till the last sessions. And the last session and the last sides. I think last side was very dangerous, considering the present scenario. Now I like to take this opportunity to propose a hearty vote of thanks to our learned faculty and I would say youngest faculty of the day. To sharing his valuable thoughts on the accounts and auditings. Sir, I on behalf of all the participants, I have to give a vote of thanks to you, sir.